it's me again.
Hello, it's me again, and welcome to my bathroom. I'm just going to show you guys how I wash my kits. So I already washed Annie, so we're just going to do the Dulcerina here. So ignore all the background stuff, just normal bathroom stuff, you know. So I'm going to point you down here to my little sink. Okay, so I have that's about everything shut up here. I use these little glass things. They in France they have yogurt. It comes in it, but make sure if you're using this alcohol. This is here they sell it for cleaning. So if you can find the 90% alcohol, that's the best to use, because that will really make sure to get everything off the baby, because when the baby's inside the mold, it gets a lot of dirt and like oil and stuff like that on the vinyl, and it makes it harder to paint on. Like when I was washing Annie, I noticed that she had a lot of like rough places, and so that's where the sealer comes in handy, because that gives you a nice even surface to paint on. I'm gonna put my chair down a little bit. I'm wearing Halloween pants. Don't know. Bye, sweetie. Saying bye to Maddie. Okay, so I'm gonna put these gloves on. Make sure you wear gloves also when you're doing this. I have cotton pads here. They're like makeup cotton pads. See? you could use paper towels, you can use anything, as long as, you know, it doesn't have any dyes on it that are gonna leak onto the kit. So I'm gonna open this lovely stuff. I am going to open my, well, I have my window up on the top open. You need some ventilation, because this stuff is pretty strong. Like I said, it's 90% alcohol, so. Okay, so we're gonna clean little Serena's little head here. So I just dipped this in the alcohol. And you want to get in all the little creases and crevices inside the ear and around the ear. Sorry about all the squeaky noises. And sorry I have on Halloween pants. It's a little weird, but you know. It's either Halloween or Christmas here for me. Okay. I just make sure to get everywhere. Okay, so sometimes you can even see the dirt that comes off. Okay, now I'm going to turn on some warm to hot water. Okay, sorry about that. I had a little interruption there. So we're back. So we already cleaned the head with the alcohol, the 90% alcohol. Now we're gonna turn this on. You want it warm, even hot is fine. So this is cream cleanser, like there's no label on mine, it's the generic kind. But you know, the kind you clean your bathroom with. It's got like kind of abrasive, kind of a little bit abrasive. It's liquid, but it's abrasive at the same time. So you just want to take either a soft sponge or a soft brush, because this already has abrasive stuff in it. And you just want to clean all the alcohol and stuff off and all anything else you missed. And so far I haven't had any problems with this kind of this way of cleaning my dolls. I'm going to keep an eye on my camera because maybe I should have changed my battery, because I have two batteries now and they're new and they don't let me know when they're going to die. So I'm going to rinse that off with some nice warm hot water. There we go. And you see how that it just like kind of beads up. And it's also a good, that's what your paint will do if you don't use sealer. You see all the little beads on there? So I'm just going to put her head right here in my lap, her clean towel. And then we just do the legs and the arms. She's got some little teeny tiny legs. Little teeny tiny skinny legs. Again, sorry about all the weird squeaky noises. I don't know, some people like that. It's like ASMR. I don't personally like the squeaky noise, but some people do. Okay, so I've got this nice and clean now. She has really cute little feet. We're gonna have fun with the cute little feet to do all the little details. And on the newborns, we're gonna make sure that the feet and the hands, if you guys ever seen like newborns, the feet and the hands, they look kind of bluish because their circulation is not yet up to par when they're first born, especially on like a preemie. On a preemie, sometimes the limbs are that way. So basically you have an idea of how I do it. I always use a clean cotton pad. Make sure to get into all the little crevices. This is gonna drive me nuts because I can't think of the name for this little part of the arm. I will think of it. I will. I haven't been feeling real good lately, guys. Gotta be honest with you. Today I'm feeling a little bit better, but I have not been feeling good. I don't like it. I work pretty hard at trying to be healthy. I know. Hard to do sometimes when you're sick, but in a wheelchair. But I do try really hard, so it makes me mad when things aren't working out. Okay, so we got an arm and a leg, so you guys get the idea of how we do this. So I'm going to finish this up and we're going to go into the bedroom, and then I'll show you how to seal. So we'll seal the babies and then we'll move on to the first layer of paint, which is for me typically blue. So I'll see you guys soon. Okay, we're back in the bedroom again. I'm sorry, it's a mess in here, my studio again. I have a box up there. I just had to buy more polyfill, so we need to get things organized this weekend. So I have this stuff all laid out here for you guys. So I'm going to show you the paints that I will probably definitely use and some paints that I may possibly use. I'm going to show you all the pan pastels. I'm also going to show you how to mix again, even though I did that before. But I only have a little bit of the purple, so I'm going to go ahead and show you how to mix it up. So, I got April Yap's tutorial. It's a free tutorial, and it's, I can't find her. She used to have a website, but I can't find it. So, the tutorial is on McPherson's. I found one little typo. By the way, this is a flange. As soon as I turned off the camera, I'm like, flange. You gotta be careful.
with pan pastels because they're very, very dark, highly pigmented powders. And if you drop them on the floor, they will stain your floor if you don't clean them up immediately with some chemicals. You want to keep some baby wipes to wipe off your hands because you don't want to touch your dolls in the wrong places. Now, you can remove pan pastels with an eraser. right now, we're going to use this eraser, which I don't recommend, but I will find my other eraser, but I'm just showing this eraser. We're not going to really use it right now because I'm going to show you the better eraser. I didn't get that out. April's having a day. When am I not? Okay. So, I'm going to clean off my hands here. And I'm going to show you everything that we have here that we need. This might, I'll try to go slow. So, in case anybody wants to get the things that they need for this before they start this whole little series. And, you know, it's going to be here forever. So, well, forever, you know. So, anytime you want to do this is fine. So, these are the paints that I most definitely will use. So, this is a golden fluid yellow ochre. This is one of my favorite paints. And then I have raw sienna, which I know looks a lot like yellow ochre, but as you can see, this is darker. And this is usually the last coat I do. Usually because I do different skin tones. I do, and there's different colors of vinyl. Now, these babies are the same vinyl, so it's good. It's all good. So, we're going to use those two. Teal, golden fluid. Sorry, it's a mess. This is also one of my favorite colors because when you think everything's going wrong and your baby just doesn't look like real skin, you put some teal on there and it's like, cool, real skin. But then it kind of washes them out, so you got to do more. But, okay, dioxazine purple. So, I will definitely use that. This is what I call my anthrax blue, you know. I'm going to spell it for you. A-N-T-H-R-A-Q-U-I-N-O-N-E. Okay, so if you guys can't see that, that's what that says. It's anthraquinone. Yeah, that's what it is. You guys know me. Okay, so I am going to use this first. If I need a blue later, I will use ultramarine blue because, as you see, this is very, very dark. So we don't want to use this too many times or we'll end up with a really muddy looking complexion. So the little of this will go a long way. So I like to use that first unless I'm doing... If I'm doing a really pale baby, I'll use the ultramarine blue. But sometimes I have gone ahead and used that anyway. So it just really depends. And I also might use my ultramarine violet. And I might use sap green hue. These are all golden fluid paints. Except for, I will use the alizarin crimson hue. And this is... high flow, and it's basically like the fluid, but it has sort of a retarder in it and it dries slower. I do have this in the fluid, but I have been using this. They say this takes longer to dry, but I really don't see a difference, so that's just me. So I may use sap green hue. And I may use burnt umber light. And then, you know, these two. The blue and the ultramarine blue and the ultramarine violet. Okay, so. I know that looks kind of boring. But that's the paints that I am going to use on these babies. So we have a form of yellow here, and we have forms of blue, and we have forms of red. So, and you know, that's just what I use. And when you look at it, you think that's all you use. That's usually. Wait, I mean, like I said, all my babies are different. When I do a darker skinned baby, a black baby, a brown baby, I use burnt umber light, and I put a little bit of ultramarine blue in there, and that makes a nice brown color. I call it my chocolate milk. And I just use different shades of that. I paint my babies all, you know, like my Caucasian babies, my white babies, and my darker colored babies all the same at first, but then I start putting more layers of this on. And I'm gonna tell you right now that, like, things that work for some people are not gonna work for other people. I know it sounds really weird because I can say, hey, use these colors. Your babies aren't necessarily going to look like mine. Because I do use these colors, just these colors, a lot, mostly. Sometimes I'll use other colors, like, see, I have other colors in here. I have, like, these are Baby FX. They are, Melissa George used to make these paints, and they're amazing paints. If you can get a hold of some, if anybody has some old that they're selling, grab them. They're really good paints. But she had to go out of business because I think something about the tint she was using, they raised the price on it. She couldn't pay for it anymore, so it was too expensive. So anyway, these are my lip colors. I like to use those. I did try the Ultimate Fusion lip colors. I don't like them at all. I also have a blush, but I use that mainly for lips too. So, but I use my powders, you know, as you know, I use my powders. I use those. I have pyrrole red. I use different reds sometimes. I do have some Reborn FX, which I also think is a good paint. I don't like the pre-mixed kind because it makes my babies too shiny. And for me, that bothers me because I can't see, like, their true shade. I mean, some people can. I just can't. So I need to be able to see the baby in kind of a matte condition. So I also have this primary yellow that I use for instead of the yellow ochre, like when I'm doing my my albino babies, because I want them to be really, really pale. And I do use Titan Buff, which is a white or an off-white, and I mix that with a tiny bit of red. And I sometimes use the Reborn FX. I do have a lot of their flesh tones, but I don't use them. The only one I have used is their baby flesh. But I'm not saying I never will, but right now I don't. I use a lot of Reborn FX, which comes from McPherson's. I use their matting powder because I can just put it into my soft touch varnish. I don't have to mix water with it. So even though the cornstarch works really well, I don't like introducing water to my varnish because it tends to make the babies turn a little whitish, because I have had to. Like recently, because I was running out of varnish, add a little bit of water to my varnish, and you spray water on your baby, like, to fix their hair. I have another Baby FX, it's a darker red. It will cause it to look white. It goes away after it dries, but it's just kind of, you know, upsetting sometimes to like people who buy the babies. This is pearl color. Sometimes this looks nice inside the ears, but you have to be careful with it because you don't want shiny. Like, I like to put this on my, my little elves and stuff inside of their ears. I think it makes it look pretty. I used to use it, on my, reason why I don't have a lot of it left is I used to use it on my isolation coat. I put a little bit of this in, but I don't use the isolation coat anymore because it was seeping out through my varnish and causing my babies to look shiny. Okay, that was a lot of info, huh? This is the best varnish. Can't say enough good things about it. And you guys know I was using Golden, and then I would use this. I am no longer using Golden. I'm just using this. It's the thing about my reborning journey is I tend to change things up. And I find new ways and different ways of doing things. And I have a lot of different products, some that I don't even use. I use, like I said, a lot of Reborn FX. I use their rooting glue. This is what I glue my hair in with. It dries really fast. It holds really good. My baby's hair is not going to fall out. I mean, unless you rip it out, it's not going to fall out. And I have their eye molding glue, which I love because it actually sticks to glass. Okay, so enough about that. Now let's get into the pan pastels. So let's see, where were we? Yeah, I lost my page. And I went this. Take me there. Yes, phone, take me here. Okay, so the colors that she recommends are, says you need Reborn FX spray sealer, which I don't have. I do have Reborn FX sealer, so I'm going to put it inside of a bottle. I still don't know if I'm going to use it or not. I'm going to try it on one of my test pieces first and see if I like it. I may just put on my powders and then maybe put a little bit of paint over it. So, we'll see. I'm sorry, this is me painting. This is how I paint. I don't follow, paint by numbers kind of thing. I just do. I see and I do. Okay, so she says to make sure you have paper towels, baby wipes. Baby wipes are good to have when you're playing with pan pastels. To have these sponges, beauty blenders, these kind of things that helps to smooth out the powders inside the creases and stuff. same way I use with my coastal scents. I'm still sad that they went out of business. Leave me hanging. Okay, so brushes. We got brushes. Another thing I should tell you guys. Okay, these are my powder brushes. All these are mainly for doing nails. There's some of them that are like little tiny brushes. sorry. Asthma. Some of them are regular brushes like this one. But most of all of my brushes I use, except for my hair painting brushes and even some of my hair painting brushes. Actually, not the hair painting brushes I use. All of them are nail art brushes. So most of these are nail art brushes and makeup brushes. I really don't really use much for, like, I use this. This is a real paintbrush. Maybe it's a makeup brush. I don't know. Most of the ones I have are real. I do have some. This one's from Pup and Tremolant, and it's a little, I need to replace this one because it's getting frayed on the end. When they start to get frayed, when you need them to go in a crease, you don't want to keep them for very much longer. So I have these special brushes that are just for yellow and blue, as you can see. These ones I use mainly for blushing. So these are all my powder brushes I have in here. These are my painting brushes, my little painting brushes. So I use these to put on paint and to dab paint in. And then I have this big thing here. These are all my kabuki brushes. So I have these a friend recommended, and these are really nice. Those are good for making texture with the varnish. But most of them I use just for painting. You want to test your bristles. You want to make sure they don't come out, because those are going to end up all over your baby. And it's hard enough to keep hair off your baby. You don't need your paintbrushes shedding. So just make sure that you have good brushes. Like I said, I love my makeup brushes. That's all I use, basically. I do have a few brushes, like this one I use for my my eyebrows. There's my mittens. And like all these new brushes that I got, these are all nail art brushes. I use them to paint hair with. Hello, baby. My mittens come jumping up in my window again. Okay, so I'm going to show you. First, I'm going to show you really quick how to mix the pan pastels. All right, I'll show you the colors first. Okay, so the colors we need. This is a lot of information. And you see her little setup. You see she has, I don't know if you can see on the phone, but she has a lot nail art brushes and makeup brushes. That's the same thing I use. And she used like beauty blenders. And she has her little wipies. It's a good little setup there. I have a big, this is the only one I could find. I have smaller ones, but you should get yourself some of these. They're like for clay and stuff and for sculpting. You can get yourself a little one like this, or you can even use a butter knife if you want. But you have to mix the pan pastels with what's called colorless blender. And like when you use like powders like the eyeshadows, you don't need to mix them. But for the pan pastels, except for the white, this is my white, you need to mix them with the colorless blender, or they're going to be just too dark and too strong. Okay, so she shows you also in the tutorial how to do it. So if I don't make sense, the pictures might help better. So she has the colors. Where's the colors? Okay, permanent red shade. This is my permanent red shade here. Hello, mittens. And this is my mixed up permanent red shade. It's mixed up with the colorless blender. So what I do is I tilt and I just take from the part where there's, you know, from the bottom of the container, like where there's just a little bit of pigment. Because like I said, these are really strong. And the next one is permanent red extra dark. Actually, did I show you the wrong one? Yes, this is the permanent red shade. Sorry. This is the permanent red extra dark. Okay. Violet. This is the one we have to do. So we'll go ahead. So I'm just going to scrape some of the violet in here. There we go. And I'm just going to put this colorless blender on top of here. Some of them come in stacks. So I've had some of them in stacks. So it's hard to figure out what is what. And they make a mess. So then you put the colorless blender in. You put about the same amount as you did the... Let's see. I'll put a little bit more in there. There we go. And then you just want to mix it together until it's all mixed. And you have one nice purpley color or whatever color you're mixing up. Actually, I like these bigger containers. I have some of them in smaller containers because I can't find any more of these big ones. But if you guys want to use these, I recommend the big ones because, like I said, you can tilt the container and just gather what you want on your brush from the edges instead of going directly into the pile of, there we go. So there you go. Now I have my violet. Okay, now I'm gonna clean off my hands. Okay, so we got violet, and then we have violet extra dark, which is a really, really, really dark. This is violet extra dark. And you have to be careful with the pan pastels. Make sure you get the exact name. Don't, because they have violet shade and violet, you know, they have all different kinds. So when it says violet extra dark, make sure it's violet extra dark, or this is just plain violet. Just says violet. Don't get violet shade or anything, just violet. Okay, so that's my violet. Yellow ochre. My yellow ochre is a mess because sometimes when they ship them to you, it breaks. So you have to be careful with that. You open it up, it's a big mess. But that's my yellow ochre, and it's already, oh, I already have that all mixed up. So there's purple paint on the bottom of that. Just ignore that. Okay, so we got that all mixed up. Put that over there with these. Where am I? Ultramarine blue. Okay, I can't find my ultramarine. Yeah, I do. I know where it is. It's in that broken one. Yeah, it's underneath here, and it's also a broken one. So you can see I have yellow sitting on top. But that's because I had to. Here, I'm gonna put this on there so we don't have to worry about that. That was because it was on my white. You see how they stack? They can stack up in towers. So my blue is in here, but it's a big mess because it's broken. And I already have it mixed up. So I got ultramarine blue. And permanent green extra dark. So this is my permanent green extra dark. And it's on top of this tower. And you can't read it anymore because it has a thing. But I promise you that it's permanent green extra dark. So we have those. And natural gray. It says natural gray. It's not natural gray. That's a typo. It's neutral gray. So this is neutral gray. And I have that mixed up in this little thing with the colorless blender. Like I said, they're all mixed up with the colorless blender. And then we have titanium white, which you use straight out of the container. You don't have to mix this. And that's all of them. And just, you know, make sure you have some colorless blender. I think these are great. I used them. The only reason why I started using the Coastal Scents, I just thought I would try them. And I really got into them. I like that they're not as harsh, let's say, as the, so you can see. You just touch something, it just gets all over. They're not as strong as the pan pastels. So they're a little more forgiving. So if you like get too much on there or whatever, you can I'm gonna cover this up because I don't want to put my hand in that. You it's okay, it's just white. But let's see. What can we put on top of here? I just want one on top of here. Sorry, I'm talking to myself. What was I going to say? If, you know, I think these are really good to use. I like using them. I still use them every once in a while. Sometimes I just, you know, get used to using my Coastal Scents. I like that my Coastal Scents, I can rub them in, you know, whatever. But as you can see, I don't use half of these. I use that one. I use that. I use this. Sometimes I use the pink. I use the purple and the blues. I use these two colors to like shade inside. And I use them sometimes for shading on darker babies. And I use my yellow, of course. Of course. About that. I'm going to put these paints away. So, hopefully that wasn't too much information. Sorry, my husband called. I'm going to to cut our little convo short. our little me trying very hard to teach you guys something. I'm not a very good teacher. I hope that wasn't too much crazy information. I'm going to put that in the garbage so I don't get pan pastels everywhere. And I'm going to cover that up. I was painting hair. Okay, we're going to make my sealer. Okay, I came up with this idea because I liked that this stuff had a little bit of grit to it, even though it's not sealer per se. It's my sealer. And it's what works well for me. Maybe I can find it and then we can mix it up and everything. It should be down here. By the way, this is a good thing to have. This is a color wheel. I highly recommend that you take your kit when you're painting. Take your kit around in different light, because sometimes your studio may look different than, you know, like out in your bedroom or in by the window where the sun is. So you want to look in different light. You can even hold in different light, you know, in your room. This is one thing Melissa George stressed a lot, and it really helped me a lot. To like, you could hold the baby down, you know, in the dark and put him under a light, or take him, like I said, I take him in my bedroom. I go all over the place, all over the house with my babies, just to try to get, you know, the true color, to make sure that I'm doing, you know, that I'm getting my baby to look as realistic as possible. So this is Liquitex Ultra Matte Gel, and it is not used for a sealer typically. A lot of people even use this as a glue for hair, but I personally don't trust it to be strong enough, but that's just me. It could work. I've never even tried it, but to me, I don't know. I like it as my sealer, and that's the only thing I use it for. So I'm going to, that's my way of saying, neener, I'm going to use this. Because when I started painting, 5 years ago in May, there was no tutorials. Well, there was very little out there to help people with air dry paints, acrylic paints. So I had to scour the internet. You know, if I spent hours and hours, days, weeks, months, just looking up things. I watched Genesis tutorials. I watched that's all there was Genesis tutorials. Like I said, there was some things in print, like some help with acrylic paints on Reborns, but generally even then it was not looked upon very, you know, nicely. But for my health, I knew that that's the only way I could do this. So I learned a lot of things by myself. You know, I just said, let's try this. And sometimes it worked out and sometimes it didn't. This is one of those things. Actually, let's use this. This is one of those things that I used and it worked out for me. So this is it's just a me thing. I didn't get this idea from someone else, but I know that there's other people who do it too. So we use the Liquitex Ultra Matte Gel. Okay. I put a little bit of this in the bottom. You see, it kind of does look like glue. So I'm not sure how well it works because I've never tried it. So I can't vouch for it, but I do know a lot of people do. So I'm going to put a little bit of distilled water. Always use distilled water because your water out of your sink, if you don't, you can boil your water if you want, but it can have, you can end up with some, like, bacteria that'll grow nasty things in your paint, and you don't want to be putting that on your babies. And you know that this is going to be, like, quality, better quality water that you're using to mix into your paints. Okay, so you can see this is kind of, it kind of looks like milk. I did it a little thicker because little Miss Annie here has some rough spots on her vinyl in places. So I want to be able to cover that really well. So I am talked out, you guys. It's been talking a mean streak. Okay, so I'm just going to brush this on. Just going to do the back of the head first. And I'm going to take this little dent sponge. These are kind of like a beauty blender because they're really dense. I like these dense sponges. I like the more ones that are more like sponges, you know, the softer ones. Sometimes for paint because it will kind of suck up the paint better. But then we're just going to pat this in with a kabuki brush. These are cheap. I buy them for like maybe 10 euro a pack. I get some of the little ones with it sometimes. I used to go on eBay and buy them all the time. And some of these are like from, you know, early on. That's a cat hair. When I started, and they still work really good. Like these pink ones, they're like my favorites. I've had these for years. I keep looking for them to see if I can find some more, but I haven't been able to find any more of the pink ones because I love those. I've seen some like it, but they're not the same. Anyway, I like those. I like my other ones. I rarely ever have to throw brushes away, even though they're cheap. So you just want to make sure you just get a thin covering. And this will kind of give a little bit like it's like a real fine sandpaper feel. And that works really good for your paint to grab onto. So when you start painting, you don't have to worry about it beading up or anything. I know that Ultimate Fusion has what's called anti-bead that will keep your paints from beading up. If your paints are beading a lot, even after you use like a sealer, that probably means that you have too much water in your paints, and you need to be really, really careful with that. Because if you put too much water in acrylic paint, it rips all the little molecules apart so they can't hold together. So the pigment can't hold together. So there's no, it will just dissipate. It will fall apart. So after a little while, your baby will look like they don't have any paint on them. They'll just fade away. Like my scientific explanation would just fall apart. My husband's a scientist, not me. Anyway, that's what will happen. Okay, I'm gonna paint the top of the head. Sorry if this has not been a very fun video. I'm in a good mood. I'm not in a bad mood, you guys, I promise. I'm just, I have been, like, really bad not feeling good. I have not been feeling good. And it kind of goes off and on, like, I'll have a day where I feel good and then I'll wake up the next day and feel terrible. So, I'm hoping that, it's just, like, a seasonal thing because the seasons are changing. Sometimes that affects me, you know, those, the things where the old lady will say, oh, I can feel rain coming on my bursitis, you know, things like that. It's kind of like that, and it's true, because changes in the weather can cause more inflammation in your body. So, where is this cat hair coming from? Really? My cats are shedding. I keep telling my kids, I'll pay them and they brush the cats. Brush the cats. And we have a, what's called a furminator. You guys know what that is? It's like a little comb. They comb through we have one for the dog and one for the cats. And it pulls all their fur out, you know, because when it gets warmer, your cats don't need their winter coat anymore. And so they start to blowing out their coats, you know. And my dog has a undercoat, so she's not actually as bad. She doesn't shed nearly as bad. My white cat that's outside all the time, Trooper. Well, she's not outside all the time, but during the day. She is really shedding, and she wants to sleep on my wheelchair. So I end up with a bunch of hair all over my wheelchair. I have a roller, and I clean it in the morning. But I still end up with hair on me, so I'm ready for their coats to be finished shedding. Okay, so there we got. She's so cute. I love how deep her little eyes are. Her little eyes are set deep in there. That's going to be fun. We're going to put a lot of blue shading and undertones in there. I get so excited when I start painting a new kit. It's like looking at all the little indentations and everything where I can put color to make them look more realistic. Anyway, when you're done with this, it feels like really, really fine. Like you're running your hand over your arm, like the little fine hairs, or like really, really fine sandpaper, like soft sandpaper. But it more feels like the little hairs on your arms. So I'm gonna go ahead. I'm just gonna do her on camera, and then I'm gonna switch back and forth. So I don't know if you guys can see, I have Annie over here, and I have little Serena over here. So I'll just switch back and forth. Like, we'll do one baby, we'll paint like one layer on one baby, and then we'll paint the next layer on the other baby on camera, just so you guys can get an idea of how I paint and how we're gonna put certain powders in certain places and more paint in certain places. Oh, she's still got water inside her. Sometimes you'll tilt the arm around and some water will come out. Usually I shake the limbs out, but these tiny limbs, sometimes they get water inside them. You have to kind of tilt them back and forth to get all the water out. I just go ahead and do the whole arm with the sealer. You'll notice I do that with my paint too. For people who are just starting out, I wouldn't recommend that. And also, I use only the two retarders, or not retarders, the two mediums. I use the satin glazing liquid, and then I use the wetting agent and mixed with distilled water. When I first started out, I was also using retarder because if you're not fast enough, or if you're just not accustomed to, I'm gonna put some more inside her hand, sorry. If you're just not accustomed to painting, it might be better to use the retarder for a little while. Just be careful, because sometimes you put... I'm going to have to clean in here. I'm going to have to come in here with the vacuum. I think I'm bringing it in. I don't allow my cats in here. They do sneak in here sometimes, as you can see. Sometimes I let them in the window, obviously. But for the most part, they're not allowed in here. But I think I bring most the cat hair in with me. Anyway, what was I saying? I don't remember. I was saying something, I'm sure, of ultimate importance. Yeah. I am in a mood today, aren't I? I don't want you guys to think I'm in a bad mood or anything, though. Because I'm not in a bad mood. I'm always excited to paint. I just want to, like, give you guys information, and I probably give too much at one time. But, it's a process, learning to reborn, you know. I don't think it's for everyone, but I think that everyone should try it. And, you know, if it's your thing and you're happy doing it, don't let anyone tell you, you know, that you can't do it or you shouldn't do it. And I think that that everyone needs to be conscious of the fact that, you know, you're just starting out. And you're not going to be able to, you know, put a baby up for sale, like your first one or whatever. I don't recommend selling, unless you're one of those people. There's some people out there who just, they paint their reborn, it looks like they've been painting for years. But that's rare. So, if, you know, just be realistic and know that, you know, you're not going to just, like, more than likely, you're not going to pick up a reborn and just be able to paint it right away and turn around and, you know, sell it for, you know, $500 or something. Because your first couple of reborns are just going to be like practice reborns. So just keep them, give them away. The first one I sold, I think I sold for a little bit over 100 euro. And she was a little tiny bountiful baby kit, Megan. And I was happy the way she turned out. I rooted a little bit of thin hair on her. I wish I had. I know I have pictures of her somewhere. I'll have to look them up. And I think she was about my fifth or sixth baby. And I think the baby after her, I made like a darker baby and I gave her to my aide. Because, you know, it was my first darker skinned baby. And I didn't feel comfortable selling her. She just wasn't very good, you know. And she wasn't up to the standards, my own standards of, I didn't feel like I could sell her. So, I mean, I'm not going to tell anybody they can't sell, you know. I mean, if you can sell your babies, more power to you. I just think that, you know, your first couple of babies should just be your practice babies. And then you can start selling. If that's what you want to do. Some people just only reborn for themselves. And that's fine too. Everybody's different. One of the reasons I decided to start painting was because I loved reborns, but I didn't want to keep them. I guess I'm just not a collector. I love my baby. I love to have the babies around, and I hold them, and, you know, and I like to dress them up and stuff, but then I get bored with them. And so I just want to, you know, I want to send them off to their mommy where, you know, somebody's going to take care of them and love them and appreciate them. I'm like one of those, you know, one of those kids who gets bored with their toys really fast. And I want the next one. And that's the fun in this, you know. It's like all, you know, you can, all the different personalities it can work with, you know. People who just want the babies for themselves. They can make their own babies and they make them the way they want them. Or there's people who are like me. Or there's people who are like a cross between a collector and an artist. They're both collector and artist. I think if someone was to like sometimes I think, you know, I should get like a friend. I have a friend that I really love her babies, especially her minis. She lives in Canada. And I thought like I should send this kit to her and have her paint it for me, you know, and I'll buy it from her, and because she makes clothes for the babies and everything. I'll leave her Reborn's nursery down in the comments, by the way, if you guys want to go check out her babies, because her babies are gorgeous and she should be painting prototypes. I'm blinking, so hopefully I won't turn off. So I think basically you guys got the idea now that I've like, I don't know, I've talked about everything under the sun. Do you want me to do the other leg? Why not? Anyway, she paints hair most of the time, but she also does some rooting. She does combo hair, and she's just really talented. I would love to have a baby by her, but then I think, you know, would I do the same thing? And I would want to keep him. I wouldn't do the same thing, actually. I would probably keep him. But she's got enough work to keep her busy. So if you guys want to go and check out her babies, and you should, I'll leave her Instagram. She puts a lot of pictures up on Instagram of her work in progress babies. I'll give you her Instagram and her I'll put her Reborn's nursery down in the comments. Do, 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 do. There's that rough spot right there. I can see it. There's one on her leg right here. I really am going to have fun painting this one. I really like her. I'm glad I bought her. Because I was being iffy. Because I was like, I bought Laura, you know, and I was like, I don't know. Had Laura on pre-order. Oh, speaking of which, I got Vito. I just paid both my kits off. I got the standing one and the sitting one, the toddler. By Laura Tuzio Ross. Is that how you say her name? I don't know. You know me. Can't pronounce anybody's name. Can't. That's why I have a hard time speaking French. My kids laugh at me. They're not mean. They're helpful, but I don't know. I don't know why I can't. You know, I've been here 11 years. You'd think I would be able to carry on a conversation in French that didn't sound like a 2-year-old, but I'm trying. I'm doing my lessons every day. Okay. I really love her little foot. Look at how wrinkly it is. That's so cute. All right, I told you guys that I was going to give up on painting little babies, and I was going to start just painting toddlers and big babies, but I love my babies. I'm looking over at Timothy. He's so cute. He's still for sale, you guys. He has, his limbs are a little weird, but he's so cute. Hit that face. It's hard not to look at, and I like holding him. He's nice and cuddly too. Very floppy and cuddly. I'm almost tempted to get another one, to tell you the truth. So I'm going to go ahead and put the sealer on little Serena. And tomorrow, we're going to start painting. And tomorrow, it won't be as long as this one. I actually might cut this one and stick it onto tomorrow's video, because this is going to be really long. I'm sorry I packed a lot of information into this one video. But if you guys, like, want to do what I'm doing. Like I said, I don't know if I'm going to use all the pan pastels, but you guys can. You guys can follow April Yap's tutorial, which I will also put in the description. So I'm putting that in the description. I'm putting my friend Amanda Gregory in the description. Let's get this, get these little tiny babies painted. These little babies. Look at how much bigger she looks, and she's so tiny. So, I'll be back tomorrow, you guys. I'm going to do this. Boom, boom, boom. Almost every day. Get sick of me. By the way, I'm at 480 subscribers. Woo! I'm almost 500, so you guys know what that means. Get to 500. I knew it was going to die on me. Okay, so when we get to 500, I'm going to make another giveaway, baby. So, at least after I finish this. So, I'll let you guys know when my subs get to 500. I'll see you guys tomorrow. If you like what I'm doing, please like and subscribe. And go get an authentic doll kit. And some paint. And paint a baby. It's fun. Okay, bye.